In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. The Lord spoke to his servant and said, Go, tell my servant David, when your time comes and you rest your ancestors, I will raise up your hair after you, sprang from your loins, and I will make his kingdom firm. It is he who shall build a house for my name, and I will make his royal throne firm forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. Your house and your kingdom shall endure forever before me. Your throne shall stand firm.
Life to the dead and calls into being what does not exist. And you would have seeking his grace to overcome that. But when I put, Mary's chest statue back in the church, I thought, well, let me personally dedicate her to protecting the United States of America, because she is the patroness of the United States of America under the title of the Immaculate Conception. And she knows, as all of us do, that our culture and our government are becoming so secularized that they see the church, the Catholic Church, as a threat to them. And so the culture, the government, and unfaithful Catholics, just dissident Catholics, are trying to do everything possible to make the Catholic Church in the image and likeness of secularism, even by law and mandate. But it won't happen because of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Immaculate Conception, our patroness. She will see to it. There may be a persecution. There may be some trial and distress over all of this. But ultimately, the Church is victorious. Governments never are against the Church. If you look at the 2,000-year history of the Church, how governments and civilizations and cultures come and go, the Church continues. But not because of who we are, but because of who God is, and because of Jesus Christ and the Blessed Virgin Mary and Saint Joseph. The Church is a hospital for sinners where Christ and his sacrifice are applied to each of us individually and collectively to enable us or to make us to be a part of the Church and have the Church triumph. In Jesus' public ministry, he had to contend with two powerful forces against him: his very own religious people, first of all, and secondly, the government of that time, Caesar and the Roman Empire. And thus it's the same today, isn't it? The characters and the names have changed, but the story is the same. Jesus, through the Church, the Pope and the bishops, have to contend with Catholics who abandon the faith or deny the faith or betray our Lord Jesus outright, as they give in to secularizing tendencies and are trying to drag the Church down the same path. Just think of our so-called Catholic politicians today, especially in President Obama's administration. But then we also have to deal with Caesar, don't we? The government's encroachment on religious liberty and freedom of conscience. Like you, I never thought that it would happen in the good old United States of America, but it is, and it will accelerate if we lose the battle of the health and human services mandate that the Catholic Church, through her self-insurance policies and in other ways, has to pay for those who are working in our institutions to have preventative health care, a euphemism for artificial contraception, sterilization, and abortifacients. If that passes, and we are able to do it, no telling what else will happen. Both battles, and with a secularized government, as I mentioned, happen throughout history. But in Jesus Christ, the Church always rises victorious, and that's our ultimate hope. How can we lose with members of the Church like the Blessed Virgin Mary, spouse of St. Joseph, her most chaste spouse, who is our patron saint in this parish? These two members of the Church are simultaneously closest to the Church and to Jesus Christ, our Savior. And in a few moments, we will experience our Savior and his unconditional love for us at this altar, when the one sacrifice of Christ will be remembered, and the priest, acting in the person of Jesus, offers Christ to the Father, and the Father accepts Christ in his sacrifice, and all of us gathered here as it is renewed for us, and as we receive him worthily. has called the reform of the ordinary form of the Mass. And one of the things that you will have noticed is that the priest has his back to you for a good part of the celebration, what is called ad orientem, or facing east, but it is also called ad deum, facing God. And the priest is not confrontational with you in prayer, but rather facing with you in the same direction toward God. That's the symbolism of it. Obviously, when the priest is on the other side of the altar, and the crucifix is there, we're facing the Lord together. And the altar itself is a symbol of Christ, so whatever side we're on, we're facing our Lord. But there's a powerful symbolism there, the priest joining the people, facing our Lord in the same direction, because we're all in the same boat. And it also helps to lessen, if you will, the identity of the human priest, so that the identity of the high priest, Jesus Christ, is made all the more clear. Because it is he who is offering the sacrifice. The priest is simply the sacramental sign of that, just as bread and wine is the sacramental sign of our Lord. We don't want to get too caught up in the bread and wine, and what kind of bread and wine it is, and so preoccupied by what the ingredients are, that we miss what the sacrament is. Our Lord Jesus Christ, his body, blood, soul, and divinity. The same with the priest. We don't want to get so caught up in the body and blood of the priest and his personality and how witty he is and how magnanimous he is and how wonderful he is, and that he has a smile on his face. I know I'm describing myself. That we miss who Jesus Christ is and what he is doing in those solemn events. Our salvation. Adoration takes the personality of the human priest out of the equation for the most part. And as I stand at the altar with my back towards you, he could be any priest in the world. It could be the Pope. Who knows? It doesn't matter. It's Christ who matters. But when I face you, or any priest faces you, doesn't the focus of attention then come upon him? His piety and how sweet he looks and how pious he is. That's not what this is about. It's about Jesus Christ. Vatican II also asked that we're allowed that the vernacular would be used in the Mass, but it specifically asked that Latin be preserved. Now, how that didn't come about, I don't know. We're trying to preserve here, obviously. But that's part of the renewal of preserving Latin, and also Gregorian chant. Now, we're singing Schubert's Mass tonight, which is not a Gregorian chant. It is an orchestral expression of the Mass, but Bo Palmer has been chanting the introit, the gradual, the tract here, the offertory antiphon, as well as the communion antiphon, in traditional Gregorian chant, as Vatican II asked us to preserve. When will this reform of the reform come about? I don't know. Pope Benedict has started the wheels in forward motion, and probably will take another generation and another pope. But many places, like St. Joseph's, are experiencing, or experimenting, I should say, with what that outcome will be. Because the Holy Father really wants the extraordinary form of the Mass that we had prior to Sacred Vatican Council, and now have again in the extraordinary form, for extraordinary reasons. He wants that Mass and the ordinary form of the Mass to look alike, so that there isn't a rupture between the two of them. So that when you come to any Mass, extraordinary or ordinary, you will have been at Mass, and the same thing will have occurred, and the same spirituality, devotion, and thrust of the Mass will have happened as well. And so that's another reason for what we are experiencing tonight, to show that it is possible, even with the Reformed Mass, which has been simplified, what is called by the Second Vatican Council, noble simplicity. And the Second Vatican Council also asked that more scripture be read in the Mass. The ordinary form of the Mass does that marvelously, and we have experienced that tonight. Tonight also we will be distributing Holy Communion by way of an intention at these two stations. And we are allowing you to kneel if you wish. If you wish to stand, you can. But because it is intention, you will have to receive on the tongue. If you've not received Holy Communion on the tongue, you simply say amen, and the priest says the body and blood of Christ, and stick your tongue out slightly so that it facilitates the placement of the host on your tongue. We thank God for the gift of the Mass, ordinary or extraordinary, for He is present and calls us to life eternal.
Thank you.
Heaven and the virtues of heaven and the blessed Sarah.
Oh, God, almighty Father, who in the unity of the Holy Thank you.
Defend with unfailing protection, O Lord, we pray, the family you have nourished with food from the soul, as they rejoice at the solemnity of St. Joseph and graciously keep safe your gifts among them. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God.